that we will focus on the emissions control technology. So before tea break, we have discussed about the EGR, that is exhaust gas recirculation system. And now I will focus on the particulate matter reduction. Now, one thing I would like to emphasize, that the particulate matter, is it a concern only in diesel engine, not in petrol engines? What do you feel? Particulate matter is a concern in petrol engine and diesel engine both? Both. So it is found in both. Particulate matter emissions are not concerned in petrol engines. There is no PM in petrol engine. Now question arises, why? You want to know why? You want to know why in gasoline NOx is not there, PM is not there? Okay. So that's why I mentioned that let understand the root cause of pollutant formation. So NOx was produced because of the high temperature, and high temperature may go in petrol engine as well as in diesel engine. Now particulate matter, what is the cause of formation? You know there are two type of combustion. One is the homogeneous combustion, one is heterogeneous combustion. Homogeneous combustion is like air and fuel are mixed properly. So there is enough time to mix the air and fuel. Number two, when they are mixed properly, the combustion is initiated and it is homogeneous combustion. It is flame propagation. So flame front is traveling from the spark plug continuously and it is reaching the farthest point. Now what is heterogeneous combustion? Where that air and fuel are not mixed homogeneously, properly. Now why properly? Because in diesel engine we are sucking only air and fuel is injected later on. When the fuel is injected, so suppose the combustion chamber volume is like this. So it is injected in the at a center. So it is not possible to mix the in the complete combustion chamber. So wherever there is a air fuel ratio is formed around 16 or 15, combustion may start, and in other area it may not start. So the combustion takes place in pockets, not continuous. So suppose it is the combustion chamber. So here it may take, here it may take, here at different points. Have you seen candle burning? What type of combustion is there? What type of flame is there? It is homogeneous or it is a heterogeneous combustion? Candle burning is not homogeneous, it is a heterogeneous. You see, when the flame is coming out and you can see a lot of black smoke, because that fuel and what they are not mixed properly. Air is, in a natural way, air is coming and just interacting with the fuel and forming the air fuel ratio, then it is burning. So heterogeneous combustion cause soot formation and particulate matter formation. Because of the lack of oxygen in some pockets, because it is not mixed properly. So that's why you can see in diesel engine, in the tailpipe there is soot formation. In petrol engine there is no soot formation. In diesel engine it is a particulate matters because of the heterogeneous combustion. And that is very fine. So particulate matter, number one, the learning is it is only a concern in diesel engine. As I told you, the particulate matter, when we inhale along with the air, it travel into the lungs and it cause the cancer in the lungs, and it may create breathing related problems. Look at the emission trend in diesel engines. From Euro 3 to Euro 4, there was a reduction of 50% in particulate matter and in NOx reduction. 50%. And if I go to Euro 2, Euro 4 to Euro 5, 80% reduction in particulate matter. And here it is a challenge. How I reduce it? How I can reduce the 80% particulate matter, because it is treated as a carcinogenic. Lungs cancer it may cause. So this we will discuss. The technology which has been used is diesel particulate filter. Now, what it means? It means it is a mechanical trap where the soot is accumulated. In that, the DPF will accumulate the particulate matter and soot. So you can see this is the diesel oxycatalyst, and here we have HC and CO. DOC is diesel oxycatalyst. Then it is passing through the diesel particulate filter, and there is a reduction of 90% particulate matter by the technology of DPF, diesel particulate filter. So DOC is diesel oxycatalyst. So whenever in the vehicle, because we have to control the HC and CO also, so for that we are using a diesel oxycatalyst which will convert the HC into H2O and CO2, and CO is treated as CO2. So CO is converted to CO2, HC, CO2 and O2. And basically in DOC it contains palladium and platinum, which serves as a catalyst to oxidize. Now it is an oxidizing reaction. So noble metal, platinum. Platinum is 2 to 3 times costlier than the gold. And if I am using that noble metal in the exhaust system, the cost of that system is very, very high. So one part is DOC I am using. Then we can reduce gravimetric particulate emissions by combining the DOC and DPF technology. So I have the DOC which will reduce the CO and HC, and after DOC I am putting a DPF. So DOC will reduce CO and HC, or DPF will reduce the particulate matter, and EGR will reduce the NOx. So combination is DOC, DPF, EGR. Now, what is the problem with DPF? I'm accumulating the soot particles. If the vehicle is traveling under highway conditions, suppose you are coming from Delhi to Chandigarh and you are coming by bus. So in that bus, if I am fitting a DPF, it may be okay, because the soot which is accumulated in the DPF, that may burn when it is running at a speed of 80 or 90 kilometer per hour speed, because exhaust will be very hot. Whatever soot is found, it will oxidize. But what happened to the buses and trucks which are moving in the city? So they are not working at a high speed. They are only 30, 40. Real problem lies there. And the problem is, when the soot is accumulated in the DPF, it starts choking. It starts clogged. Clogging may take place and it may completely or partially clogged. And if clogged, what happened? If it is clogged, then back pressure of the exhaust system will increase. What will happen if your exhaust gas pressure increases? So what? If the back pressure increases, engine performance start reducing. And if the back pressure reduces significantly, engine may stop. Engine may stop. It will not work at all. So that is the problem. So to avoid this problem, what has been done? We have used a concept that is known as active regeneration system, filter regeneration. It means while putting in the vehicle only, there is some concept you can implement so that all the soot is cleaned off. So either you remove that, then clean it and refit again, but nobody is going to do that. So regeneration is done. So there are two type of approach for regeneration. Approach number one is active regeneration, and approach number two is passive regeneration. In active regeneration, particularly in low temperature operating routes, like the in city driving conditions, that you have to use the external source to heat the DPF. And there are different approaches. Either you can heat it electrically, you have some heater, you can heat that DPF, and all the accumulated particulate matter, they may oxidize. Because in city condition, the temperature is not going above than 300 degrees Celsius. And oxidation take place only above 400, 450 or 500. So what you do? Either you do it externally by electrical heating, number one. Number two, you can do it by injecting the appropriate quantity of fuel in the near the DPF. So that is an oxidation technique which will burn and increase the temperature of the DPF. Number three, in passive regeneration, how it is done? In passive regeneration, if the vehicles are running at a high route, then on the DPF, I can put the higher loading metal like platinum and palladium. So they are the catalyst. They will accelerate the reaction and the temperature may be increased. But you have to add a cost. And secondly, it is only possible on the highway driving conditions. So passive technique is possible on the highway driving conditions. And in passive technique, we are using the advanced formulation loading. Advanced formulation loading means it is a platinum and palladium. Regeneration technique. Passive regeneration, that I told you, catalytic formation, and active regeneration is heater and real-time injection. Now, in real-time injection, it means you need some sort of a system. When to inject, how much to inject, that both are very important. So that complete system of active regeneration system is called DPF active regeneration system. And luckily, we have a demo kit for DPF active regeneration system within in our studio, and I am going to demonstrate on that education kit, which is a real-time operating system. I will tell you what are the parts of this technology and how it works. So before that, I would like to throw some light through my PowerPoint presentation. You see, here it is a filter. After some time it is clogged because the smoke is there, particulate matter is there, so it is clogged. So I am heating it and regeneration takes place. Here regeneration is taking place, and when the regeneration takes place, your filter becomes again almost new. And this process is done automatically during the running of the vehicles. Driver need not to do that, because all the drivers, operator, owner, they are not interested in controlling the emissions. They control, they are interested more in the fuel economy. So if pollution is increased, they never bother. But environment bother, society bother, country bothers, global warming bother. All these things are happening, you know. Let's look at the principle of operation of this active regeneration system. So we have a DOC, diesel oxycatalyst. Then we put the DPF, that is a diesel particulate filter. Then we put the electronic control unit, a real parameter monitoring system, and regeneration control strategy. A fuel reservoir, from where generally we take from the diesel fuel tank or return of the fuel pump, a small reservoir. Then fuel injector we need, and these fuel injectors are of very high quality because they are mounted on the DPF in the exhaust system where the temperature is 200-300 degrees Celsius. So the quality of the injectors is very important. Onboard indicator on the vehicle driver to monitor the system health. If something goes wrong, the driver should be able to understand that there is some malfunctioning in the DPF, so you please go to the service station and go for the necessary changes. Diesel fuel is injected in the hot engine exhaust and the temperature is raised. But here the important point is how much, what is the quantity of the diesel engine, diesel fuel which is to be injected and when to be injected. So both are very critical and having a paramount importance. This is the schematic and structural configuration of the diesel particulate filter regeneration system. Look at this. We have a diesel tank. Diesel fuel is coming, so I am using some sort of a filter, and then this fuel is through the ECU command, then it is sent. Here we have a pump inside this. It is pressurized to 5 bar, and then the fuel is coming to the injector, which is mounted here. It is clear? It is mounted in the exhaust system. Now when to inject, how I know it? So for that, what we have done, we have put a back pressure sensor which monitor the exhaust back pressure. Clogging means pressure drop will be more. Suppose when I have put the new filter, the pressure was in the exhaust system say 120 kilopascal. When the clogging start, it will start increasing. The pressure may become 140 kilopascal. When the pressure is 140 kilopascal, it means delta P is around 20 kilopascal, then I can put in the control strategy, okay, now this is a condition. That is one condition, but what about other conditions? I should have the temperature also measurement. So I measure the temperature also here. Because why temperature I am measuring? Because when I am injecting fuel, so the condition is okay, back pressure has increased, now inject. But I should inject when the there is sufficient temperature there. If the temperature is below 200 degrees Celsius, whatever fuel I will inject, it will not oxidize. So the condition is I should have enough temperature, that is around 210 degrees Celsius. Only then, if both the conditions met, and I can put some other conditions also, it is a control strategy for the very basic. I tell you, I just would like to emphasize on the very basic concepts. So temperature and pressures are monitored, and based on the temperature and pressure, if they meet the requirement as per the control strategy, the fuel will be, ECU will dictate the pump, okay, now inject the fuel here. How much quantity? For what is the duration of injection? How long I inject it? Suppose I have started, okay, tick, 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 tick. But when I stop, at what rate I should inject? The idea is, suppose the temperature of the exhaust gases is 220 degrees Celsius and I need to achieve 500 degrees Celsius. So I know the mass flow rate, I know the specific heat of the gases, and I want delta T, say I want to raise the temperature by 300 degrees Celsius. So I will find out the mass of fuel required, that is a Cp is equal to T2 minus T1. Knowing the calorific value of the fuel. So that quantity of the fuel I am going to inject. And continuously I am monitoring the temperature of the exhaust system. When the temperature again rising, then if it is reaching very close to 500, then what should I do? I should stop the injection. Am I right? How to stop? Again, there is some, and I cannot stop abruptly. I should give some time. So that is all built up in the ECU, which we have to show you on the in the studio. So this ECU includes control electronics. There is a ICs, some driver circuit, injection pump, and then because I am monitoring the back pressure from the exhaust system. So this back pressure, if I am giving directly to the back pressure sensor, it is exhaust gases, some dirt is there, it may damage it. So there I have to use a water separator. You see in the ECU box here, you can see a water separator. This is a water separator. So exhaust gases are, moisture is separated and then it is entering here. Then here it is LED, light emitting diode display. We have green, red and yellow. If there is any malfunctioning, it will be displayed here. What is the error code? That again we can check and we can know what is the problem. Another important thing, we want that all this monitoring, exhaust temperature, exhaust back pressure, engine speed, engine load should be monitored continuously. So we have an arrangement of data logging. So data is logged when the vehicle has started, when the what is the temperature, what is the pressure, what is the driving cycle, everything is monitored in this. And that data you can retrieve and you can look in last 1 week how many times regeneration has taken place. So that is also very beneficial for the research purpose. Now I am showing you the another picture of active regeneration concept. You can have a look. Here it is an engine. Here I am measuring the temperature. Here it is a heater, which may be optional, because if sometimes your fuel is not working, you may have the electrical heater also. Then you can put another temperature sensor ये दिस इज द डीपीएफ बिफोर डीपीएफ एंड आफ्टर डीपीएफ. सो दीज आर द ऑप्शनल. यू कैन यूज टू टेम्परेचर सेंसर, थ्री टेम्परेचर सेंसर, फोर टेम्परेचर सेंसर. सो योर कंट्रोल स्ट्रेटजी विल चेंज अकॉर्डिंग टू द टेम्परेचर यूज. मोर द इंफॉर्मेशन, मोर द एक्यूरेसी, मोर द कॉम्प्लिकेशन. सो दिस इज द एक्टिव रीजनरेशन ईसीयू. दिस इज द सीरियल कम्युनिकेशन पोर्ट. दिस इज द फ्यूल फिल्टर. दिस इज द थर्मोकपल्स टू मेजर द टेम्परेचर इन द एग्जॉस्ट सिस्टम. एंड दिस इज द फ्यूल पंप विच इज बिल्ट इन साइड द ईसीयू which will increase the pressure of the fuel up to 5 bar. And then this is the pressure sensor which is mounted into the ECU to measure the exhaust back pressure. And these are the fuel inlet and outlet, because the extra fuel may go out to the tank. This is the spring nozzle which is mounted on the exhaust system. And this is the water separator which is used in the ECU box here. This is the water separator which is shown here. So now you just have a look on the different parts of the active regeneration system. Water separator, ECU, communication port, fuel filter, thermocouples, fuel pump, pressure sensors, and fuel supply. And then over and above, you have a diesel particulate filter. This is the ECU. So this is some electronics which has gone inside the ECU. It defines the microprocessor speed, working voltage, channels, analog to digital converters, now I will just show you the pump operation, because this is very important, that to inject the appropriate amount of fuel, the pump accuracy is very important. In each pulse, it can inject 64 microliter of fuel. So whatever you need, and the fuel is injected at a 5 bar pressure. So this is the diesel. You can see here the pump from the diesel fuel tank. This is going in the fuel pump and then in the nozzle, and it is injected in the near DPF. Now these are the different parts of this pump. This is the metric pump. This is the spring. This is the pintle. And this is the connector which gives the supply to this. The pump can be operated at 12 volt as well as at 24 volts. Because in USA, most of the big trucks and buses, they have the battery supply of 24 volts. So accordingly, your injection duration may change. Your quantity of the fuel to be injected may be changed. So you have to change a little bit in the control strategy. So this is the water separator. It removes the water, moisture, dirt, and other impurities from the exhaust system so that your back pressure sensor may not be damaged. fuel filter to remove the impurities. Then this is a pressure sensor which is measuring the, it is differential type, its range is 0 to 100 kilopascal difference. Voltage supply is given. Then you have the thermocouples, which are K type thermocouples, which has been used in the present application. Now, what I would like to do now with this background, because I have shown you each and every component on the presentation, I would like to demonstrate on the components lying on the table, and all these parts, you can see the functioning of each and every part, you can see the physical concept of the parts and how they are operating, everything we can see. In the meantime, the camera is coming on the system. I will discuss with you the wiring diagram of this system. Like here you can have a look, you have two thermocouples. So both are going to the main ECU connector. Then we are taking the engine speed from either engine alternator, or we may use some crank or cam position sensor. And the battery may be 12 volt or 24 volt. And here you have the LED showing the filter conditions. If it is dirty, red will glow. If it is okay, green will glow. If it is in between, yellow will glow. So let's go to the system. Again, here we have power supply. Which is 12 volt. The 12 volt is given to the ECU. This is a wiring harness, the green color. You can see this is wiring harness. Whether the supply is on and if there is any malfunctioning in any of the circuit, this is a MIL. You can say malfunctioning indicating lamp. If there is a problem, it will blink from green to red or yellow. Then you can have a look. This is the thermocouple, K type thermocouple, which is mounted in the exhaust system just before BPF. Before diesel particulate filter. This is another K-type thermocouple which is mounted after the diesel particulate filter. These both have the capability to measure the temperature up to 1000 degrees Celsius. The selection of what type of thermocouple is used, it is very important from the accuracy and from the durability point of view. Now next, come to the water separator. This is connected to the exhaust system. Exhaust back pressure is measured. Exhaust gases are passed to the water separator and then it is going to the ECU so that all the dirt will be removed here, and this is connected to the back pressure sensor which is mounted inside the ECU. This is the main ECU. Inside this ECU, you can see this is the fuel inlet supply which will come from the diesel engine. The fuel will get in. This is the filter. Any impurities in the diesel fuel will be removed here, and then it is supplied to the pump which is mounted inside the ECU.
The outlet pressure is around 5 bar, and from here the a high intensity and density pipe will be connected to the nozzle, which will be mounted on the exhaust system. Now all this data, temperature and pressure, and through ECU we can monitor through the software on the laptop. Now you can see this is, we have displayed here all the parameters are mounted. Now you can see the temperature at this moment is shown as 24 degrees Celsius. So this is the screen where we can plan and we can change regeneration interval, what is the back pressure on time, what is the temperature on time, what is the temperature off, and what is the injection pulse width. Here we have kept 8 milliseconds, you can change it. And if I will just start it, you can try to listen the, when I will start it, the pump inside this will work, and you can see the and listen the sound of tick tick tick. Now I am trying to start it. You can see the sound, pump starting operating, fuel is going, can go in, and now it is to be injected. The tick tick, that is at around 8 millisecond pulse width is there. You can listen it. And based on the control strategy, the rate of injection may increase or it may decrease. Now when this fuel is injected, where it is to be injected, now look at this. This is a very complex design BPF. You can see, you can focus here. This is a diesel particulate filter. It has got a honeycomb structure. You can look at this. And we generally define it like this is 400 CPI. CPI means cells per sparing. 400 cells in 1 inch area is there. So you can see what, how fine the cells is there. So exhaust gases are passing through this and all the soot will be forming. Again you see, we have developed a control strategy. You can see the sound is now increasing. The rate of injection is increasing now. Just listen it. It is increasing. So when it will increase till the temperature is in the desired range. When the temperature will be reached in the desired range, then it will start reducing. This fuel will be injected just in this BPF, near this BPF. When the fuel will be injected here, oxidation will take place and it will burn all the soot which is formed inside this diesel particulate filter. And the condition of this filter will become again brand new. So why we are doing like this? Because this filter cost around 45,000 rupees, one printer, this one. And if I am coating it with platinum and palladium, another I am adding 40,000 rupees. The cost of this filter with coating is around 85,000. More than the cost of a motorcycle. So again I am repeating, this is diesel particulate filter. Fuel, you can see it is in the process of injection. Temperature is monitored by the thermocouples. Pressure is monitored by the pressure sensor built up inside the ECU. This is the water separator. And this is the MIL, malfunctioning lamp. If anything goes wrong, it will blink red. But now it is going well. Pulse width is kept around 8 milliseconds. Frequency is around 100 now. And this is the power supply because the ECU operates at 12 volt. Now, I am stopping this. I can click here. Now it stops. So I can optimize all these parameters written on this table, and here everything is displayed. What is the thermocouple 1 temperature, thermocouple 2 temperature, what is the frequency of injection, every parameters is displayed here. And you can change it, you can optimize all these parameters. Thank you. Now, I think we can have some questions, because this is a very important technology, and for your kind information, this technology at this moment only available in USA, Japan, Germany. In India, this technology is not implemented at all. It may be implemented in a year or two. So the technology which I am showing you, it is even not available in India as on date, but it is coming shortly. It is in research stage. We have developed it, and it may be fitted in the vehicle from 2016. So now I open the session for questions, because we have talked a lot, so we would like to have an interactive session. So now question, please, from different sensors about diesel particulate filter and active regeneration systems. With demo we have finished, yeah? With demo we have finished, but lecture may go on little bit. So I prefer, if there is some question, we can connect to the centers, different centers. So if there is any question till this moment, so we can answer those. Yes, please. Yes.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Hello, sir. Yes. Sir, you can go to heterogeneous combustion and homogeneous combustion as well. Both of these combustion, in terms of their comparison, then how can we articulate that as far as I am concerned, with heterogeneous combustion, that it is defined as the combustion of different substances or specific about in general. Either in the definition of a different matter or in general amount of different matter, as far as I am concerned, the heterogeneous combustion.
Can you repeat your question slowly?
I'm not Sir, you talked about engines in the session, you talked about heterogeneous combustion and homogeneous combustion.
Yes, slowly, yeah, homogeneous combustion and heterogeneous combustion, yes.
Yes. So, I just need to articulate the definition comparison. So, if I'm required for heterogeneous combustion, then can I define it as a different combustion for different factors? Either in definite amount or in indefinite amount, I just need to know it here.
Last part is still not clear. Yeah, I understand you are asking about heterogeneous combustion, but what is exactly your question? That is not clear to me, please.
Heterogeneous combustion, if I will define about heterogeneous combustion, how I will define it, is it the combustion of different substrates or matter in definite amount or in indefinite amount?
Okay, let me explain. I try to make you more clear. You know, there is, ideally speaking, even homogeneous mixture means we have given enough time to the air and fuel to mix properly, so the distribution of fuel in that volume is uniform. In case of heterogeneous, yeah, it is distributed very uniformly in case of homogeneous. In case of heterogeneous, it is not distributed uniformly. So whenever wherever the mixture is suitable for combustion, for oxidation take place. So oxidation take place in diesel engine at many hundred points into the combustion chamber, whereas in petrol engine the combustion take place at only one point near the spark plug, then the flame propagates from there in the form of waves. In heterogeneous, Yeah, if you use blending of petrol, 1 minute. What was the question? Can you just click again? Okay.
If I will compare the definition between the homogeneous and heterogeneous combustion, so when I define it, say I will start with heterogeneous combustion, that is defined as the combustion of different substrates or matter present in the system, either with definite amount or with indefinite amount of proportion.
Sir, excuse me, sir. Excuse me, sir. Hello. Sir, आप ना ये external mic मत use कीजिए, just system के पास आके आप पूछ लीजिए, then clear होगी आपकी voice. Sir, ये external mic मत use कीजिए. Sir, just system के पास आके अपना question पूछ लीजिए.
माइक मत यूज कीजिए आप, डोंट यूज माइक,
ये वाला माइक मत यूज कीजिए.
हाँ, अब ऐसे आ रही.
तो
नहीं, देखो, I think there is a little bit confusion. I am trying to answer. It is not the combustion is not of the particulate matter in the combustion chamber, but when we are talking about the homogeneous and heterogeneous, it is the first primarily it is the mixture, whether the mixture is homogeneous or the mixture of air and fuel is heterogeneous. That is the first thing. Terminology. स्मोक को रिड्यूस करने के लिए व्हाट यू कैन डू, यू कैन प्रोसीड फ्रॉम हेटरोजीनियटी टू होमोजीनियटी. Yeah, that is the only method. Means what I can do, like if you see from the engine point of view, I can increase the injection pressure. Earlier we were using around 200 to 300 bar injection pressure in diesel engine, and nowadays we are going above 1000 bar. Why we are going to 1000 bar? Because to increase the homogeneity, so that atomization of the diesel fuel is very very fine and it can mix with the air and it is more homogeneous as compared to earlier. So the PM can be reduced by atomizing the fuel of the diesel at a very high pressure, and then it will be mixed easily because very fine drop nanoparticles will mix very smoothly, very homogeneity in the air, and it will result in lower PM reduction. Okay. Yeah, please.
Please explain the structure and material used for DPF. And sir, another question is, if we use blending of petrol like of Brazil, can the problems of emission can be controlled and by what extent?
So first question is the structure and material used for DPF. The DPF structure is, it is like a honeycomb structure, you can see, and we define this as a either it is 200 CPI or it is 400 CPI or it is 300 CPI. CPI stand for cells per inch. If I am looking at one cell, if you see, this is the DPF and we have number of cells in this. So suppose this area is say 8 inches. So 8 inches square area, if I am using a terminology 400 cells per inch. So in this you have 400 into 8, 3200 cells will be there. This is the cells, small cells. More the number of cells, more will be the reactivity. But more will be the sensitivity to back pressure also. So this material what we are using, generally commonly material uses ceramic. We are using ceramic for making the DPF structure. And it is honeycomb structure, honeycomb type of structure. You can see this. So that is the answer of the first question. Now second question is, if we use blending of petrol like in Brazil, can the problem of emissions? Now emission is a very broad word you have used. I want to know which type of emissions, because in petrol particulate matter is not there. So DPF is meant for particulate matter, and in petrol there is no particulate emissions. And if I am mixing the methanol or ethanol in the gasoline, what we call it blend, then particulate matter is generally not there. But if you are talking about other emissions, please be clear. Yes, please. Yeah, if we are adding the ethanol or methanol, generally NOx, it depends what is the blend, but because generally by adding the ethanol or methanol, they have the high latent heat of vaporization. They consume more heat from the combustion chamber and they lower down the cylinder peak temperature. So with this concept, generally we have observed that by adding the alcohol fuel, NOx may be reduced. However, it depends upon the percentage. In Brazil, it may be used in 80%. So NOx is expected to reduce with gasoline and alcohol blends. Yeah, next.
Sir, I have one question. After how many kilometers you can got cloaked? Is there any average?
No, actually that is again, it depends what type of vehicle is there, but generally and under what driving conditions you are using the vehicle, under what load and speed conditions you are using the vehicle. But you can say complete clogging of DPF may take place in say 24 hours if continuous running is there. And again, it depends upon the what type of particulate matter it has got, what is the condition of the engines. But again, the experiment shows that the vehicle running after 3 to 4 months may cause clogging of the, because if you are using the active regeneration system, then that measurement is not available. Because continuously you are using the active regeneration system, so you cannot say when it will be clogged. But yes, when it is near to clog, suppose 70% clogging is there, that is around in 4 or 5 months. Again, it is not very precisely, depends upon the driving conditions, engine, particulate matter level also. He has written, what are the effect on NOx to regeneration system? We
increase fuel ratio to increase the temperature. What is the effect on the fuel
efficiency? I think there is a little bit confusion in your understanding. What we are injecting the fuel, we are not injecting into the combustion chamber. We are injecting in the DPF, near the DPF in the exhaust system. So air fuel ratio, what we are talking generally, terminology which we are using, that was for the combustion chamber point of view. Here in the diesel particulate filter which is in the exhaust system, we are injecting the amount of certain fuel in the diesel exhaust system, not into the combustion chamber. So it will not enhance the or neither affect the efficiency of the engine, because it is not in the engine. It is the after treatment technology. It is in the tailpipe. It is in the exhaust. So engine combustion will not be affected by doing this. actually, you know, what we are discussing now, these are, you know, to control the emissions, there are two type of technology. One is the technology which can be adopted inside the combustion chamber. Another we call it after treatment technology. After treatment technology means when the exhaust emissions are coming out of the engine, it is going into the exhaust system, there we are making a treatment for that. That is either we are putting a catalytic converter, either we are putting a diesel oxycatalyst, either we are using a DPF, either we are using a SCR system, that is a selective catalyst reduction by injecting the urea, or we are using any other technique. EGR is not after treatment technology. EGR is inside the combustion chamber. So it is the inside the combustion. So there are generally three treatments from the emissions point of view. One is pre-treatment also. It means I am treating the fuel. I am passing the fuel through the magnetic system or such that it is prone to good combustion. So it is a pre-treatment. When I am doing into the combustion chamber, like if I am changing the ignition timing, I am controlling the emissions or NOx inside the combustion chamber. So that is the inside the combustion chamber. So pre-treatment, engine treatment, and after treatment. There are three technologies. So DPF is a after treatment technology. Catalytic converter is an after treatment technology. EGR is a engine technology. And pre-treatment technology, some people are, they are also trying that. So these are the three categories to control the emissions. Any other question from any other center? Yes, please. Any question, please? If no question, then I would like to summarize what we have covered in this session. We have talked about why in India we are not, there is a question. Yeah, there is a, you know, this is important question. I think in Europe now, we in European countries, they are adopting Euro 5 already, and now they may are planning to gear up for Euro 6 in next 1 or 2 years, and we are still at Euro 4. So why we are not coping with the European norms? There are basically two reasons for this. Number one is the technology to integrate in the engine and vehicle. So we are far behind in the technology. Even we have the international manufacturer in India, like we have the Toyota, we have the Honda, we have the Volkswagen, we have the Suzuki. So they may have the technology because they are producing the car in Germany and in Japan and in USA. So they may have the technology. But the another issue, very important issue, that is the availability of the fuel. Because if I am making a Euro 5 technology, it is not only the technology, it is the fuel also. Suppose I have a dirty fuel. If the sulfur level is very high in the fuel, so the technology is not, cannot do anything. So technology need and good quality fuel also. So all this refinery, and suppose if I am using a, now suppose diesel, in diesel fuel suppose there is a sulfur level is 60 ppm and I want that it should be 10 ppm to reduce the pollution, or octane number should be high. So the refinery to upgrade the fuel quality from Euro 3 to Euro 4, they have to invest in millions crores. There is a huge investment. Even now, for your kind information, we are Euro 4 only in 11 metropolitan cities. For fuel quality is not available in rural areas. So there still it is Euro 3 norms. The vehicle which are sold in the outside the NCR regions or outside the metropolitan city, they are Euro 3. Why they are Euro 3? We have the technology for Euro 4, but we do not have the fuel production to meet the Euro 4 requirement. So the first target is in all over India, I think we are planning in 2016, all over India you should be Euro 4. Now it is some part of the country is Euro 3, some part of the country is Euro 4. So we want to make it one. So the fuel quality and technology, they are two issues. Fuel quality is a major issue, then the engine technology. No, that's why I answered that even today the fuel is not available. That is the fact of Euro 4 quality. Otherwise, we would have done it all over India. So Euro 4 is only available in the metropolitan city. So some refinery, they have to cope up with that. And then when you are introducing Euro 5, again the fuel quality is to be enhanced. And technology of the engine and fuel quality will go hand in hand to reduce the emissions. So both has to be go parallelly. So that's why technology more or less is available, but fuel quality is slightly behind in this context. Any question from any sensor, any center? Any question? Okay, no question. Okay. Let's summarize before lunchtime. We have 2-3 minutes. So I can just summarize before the lunch. So DPF is the technology to reduce the particulate matters. Particulate matters are produced only in the diesel engines. The root cause of particulate matter formation is the heterogeneous combustion, and it can be improved by injecting the fuel at a very high pressure into the combustion chamber. Diesel particulate filter accumulate the particulate matter, but by accumulating the back pressure increases. When the back pressure increases, the filter start clogging. This clogging depends upon the type of engine, the running condition of the engine, the speed of the engines, and there are some other factors also. That's why to avoid it, we have used active regeneration system, which monitor the condition of the filter when the condition of the filter is not good, it is partially clogged, then I have to decide when to inject, for how long I have to inject, and at what temperature I have to inject. For this, we have to develop the control strategy. The control strategies are the main intelligence which is inside the firmware, and then you can operate, you can test the system. For active refrigeration system, we have looked at the different parts. We have the ECU, we have the thermocouples to measure the exhaust gas temperature, we have the back pressure sensor to measure the back pressure, we have the water separator, then we have the MIL, mild functioning lab, then we have a fuel pump which is pressurizing the fuel at 5 bar, and then it is, we have an injector which is directly mounted in the near the DPF, and then we have a diesel particulate filter. Some question has been asked about the diesel particulate filter. Diesel particulate filter construction is honeycomb structure. Basically, it is a ceramic and it is very expensive. The technology is even not, nobody is manufacturing the DPF as on date in India. It is all imported. DPF technology may be going to be implemented in next few years in India. This technology is all already available in Japan, Germany, and USA. People are using this. Active regeneration and passive regeneration, there are two concepts, two options available. Active is what we are using, either chemically we are heating the DPF or by electrical method we are heating. That is also possible. Then in passive regeneration, we are coating the noble metal in a larger quantity. The cost increases, but that is suitable in the highway driving conditions. So all these things are available for diesel engines, for vehicles. DPF is a technology which may see the light in by 2016 in India. The fuel quality should be also available to cope up with the engine technology. And before T, we have used the EGR technology. We have the demonstration how to reduce the NOx, what is the origin of the NOx formation, and how they affect our health also. And now we have a lunch break, and we will meet you again around 2 o'clock.